did you first grow curious about the paranormal? Dare you dig deeper? You are listening to Howls of Asher.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the show. This is House of Asher. I'm your host, Steve Asher, and we are up to episode 59 at this point. And a few episodes back, we had a guest on, and we were talking about exorcisms and, you know, demonic possession, and how that ties in with the Catholic Church, and how it ties in with our particular guest, who is a psychic medium, and how the gifts of this and that, you know, aid him as, you know, being a very involved member of the church and does a lot with the community. And our special guest actually is Robert Righi. Sir, welcome back to the show.
Thank you very much, Stephen. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the House of Asher. I appreciate being on air with Steve, and you're a great host, great interviewer, and tonight we're going to continue talking about Kevin, and then we're going to talk about another case of, this time it is a female, and her name is Vivian. But we'll kind of like talk a couple minutes or so about Kevin and have some closure with that. And then we can talk about Vivian. And if you have any questions for me, please ask me anytime, okay?
Sure. I do want to get in here real quick and let everybody know that this is, you know, this is can get little hairy, you know, because this, you are dealing with a very dark entity, one of the most ancient entities in the world, demons. And for those who maybe have weak constitutions or whatever, feel free to tune out now. I don't hold it against you, but like I said, understand it could cause you some nightmares. So just fair warning. Okay, if those that are still here, cool, great, stick around and let's listen to Robert. Go ahead, Robert.
Thank you so much. I am Roman Catholic, and my spirituality is based on my Roman Catholicism. And this past Saturday, but then the Roman Catholicism world was the feast of St. Michael the Archangel. And I always begin when I do any interviews or go into any investigation, I always say the prayer to St. Michael the Archangel. So I'm going to be saying the prayer. And being Roman Catholic, that I bless myself first, okay? And I say this prayer for everyone who is listening, okay? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in this day and night of spiritual battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl through the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. St. Michael the Archangel, pray for us, protect us. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Last week, I spoke about Kevin. And so what I wanted to do tonight is have some closure regarding Kevin. I know that a lot of people want to hear the gore and different things that have gone on during the exorcism. And so tonight, just briefly, I'm going to be talking about physical manifestations of the devil, of the demon, and I'm also going to say the demon's name tonight. I usually don't, but my spirit is encouraging me to do so. So I will be telling everyone the demon's name. Okay, and again, when you say the demon's name, any demon's name, it is a calling card, and I always pray to St. Michael the Archangel to protect us, to guide us, and I know that he's with us this very moment, as he always is with us. During the exorcism of Kevin, of course, we went through psychological testing, 2 days of that, but during the psychological testing, as well as going through the exorcism with Kevin, there were certain things that happened. Like I said before, did his head turn around? No, it did not. Did he vomit? Yes, he did. Did he wet himself? Yes, he did. Did we have to restrain him? Yes, we did. And again, I must tell everyone that he did sign a form, a legal form, him, giving us permission to do so. It was also videotaped, and the videotape has been sent and is used in teaching young priests and others regarding the rite of Roman exorcism. Okay, and again, Kevin's girlfriend was there. I was there. There were there were Catholic priests. There were four of them all together. Two of them were the main exorcists. One of them was a psychiatrist, and also a medical doctor. We also had paramedics downstairs. This was done at a monastery in Chicago. I can't tell you where, but the main exorcism, his name is Father Michael. Okay. During the psychological testing, I was there. The psychiatrist, as well as the psychologist, were going through the different types of tests. Just not psychological tests, but also a lot of blood work and those types of things. During the psychological testing, the demon came through and started to cackle, started to laugh, used very, very foul language, in which I cannot use on the air, okay? But one can just imagine, okay? And again, with a real guttural voice, and Kevin's body began to change. Every time that the demon came through, Kevin's body changed completely. Did he grow long fingernails, and did he, you know, did he grow hair? No, he did not. But it's just the fact that his neck, his throat got very, very thick. He began to exhibit a lot of aggression. And so at times we had to restrain him. And again, he signed that release to protect himself, as well as the church, as well as those of us who were in the room. During the time that, like I said, that he was going through some psychological testing, the demon, I will tell you the demon's name. The demon's name is Baal, one of the worst, nastiest, aggressive, mean, sadistic demons around, okay? So be very, very careful. Okay, when the demon came through again, he is mine. I have his soul. Your God means nothing. Jesus died for nothing. And so those types of things came through. I kept saying Kevin's name, and when I would do so, Kevin's eyes would open real wide, and he started to nod his head. And he began to speak as Kevin. And again, one must be very, very, very careful, because as we know, Jesus calls the demons, devil, Lucifer, Satan, the king of liars, of all liars. He's very cunning. And so we had to be very, very careful, especially because of Kevin and for us also. There were also during the times of which Kevin just passed out completely. And again, the paramedics were there, psychiatrists, medical doctors, psychologists, took blood pressure. Kevin was fine physically. And again, the demon just doesn't attack one's physical body, but also emotionally and spiritually. After the psychological testing was done, 2 days, it wasn't like 6 hours consecutively. It was 2 or 3 hours for a while, and then we went back to give Kevin a rest, giving some nourishment. He walked around. We were there to protect him. And so again, we went back and did some more testing. And during that time, the demon did not come through. After the psychological testing, it was deemed that Kevin was emotionally fit. There were no signs of any psychological problems. Kevin was not schizophrenic. He was not paranoid schizophrenic. He was not schizoid. He was not bipolar or anything like that. So truly, Kevin was truly possessed by a demon. And again, the demon came through during the exorcism, starting to say things about me and my past, as well as the other two priests and some seminarians that were there. and again that we were told not to have any conversation, not to validate what the demon says at all, because the demon will try to do anything to take us off of the exorcism and to bombard us with so many different things. So it's very, very dangerous. So I'm telling everyone, please, if you don't know how, don't have the expertise in the rite of exorcism or deliverance, please do not try to do this, please, because it is very, very harmful. It can turn out horribly for the person who needs to be delivered and or exorcised, and also for the person who's doing it. During the time of the exorcism, like I said, that Kevin did have to become restrained, there are certain times where the windows began to shake, the door would slam open, the stench was incredible, the guttural sounds from his throat were unbelievable. There was one time that there's something called echolalia, and echolalia is we have two sets of vocal cords. One of them is dormant. The Tibetan monks know, and they've been trained to use both vocal cords, and so they will do that in their chanting and such within their own religion. And during the time that during this exorcism, Kevin, because of the demon, began to exhibit echolalia. So there were some parts that Kevin was saying in Latin, and Kevin did not know Latin at all. There were other times, at the same time, that also the demon would say certain things in Greek, and the priests and the seminarians knew both Latin and Greek. I know a little Greek, but I know more Latin, so we knew that he was talking about. There were times that when we were saying the prayers within the Latin rite of Roman Catholicism, that the demon began to say some of the prayers and answer the prayers in Latin, mocking the prayers that we were saying. There were certain times when it looked like that Kevin's eyes were going to bug out of his face. They became very, very enlarged. His pupils were just massive. He began to cry. He began to whimper. And then all at once, this incredible, horrible cackle and laugh. And then the demon would say, F you, screw you, he is mine, your God has no power at all. There are certain times when Kevin began to thrash around, and again, Kevin gave us the legal permission to have him restrained to protect him as well as to protect us, and so the restraints were put on during that time. When Kevin relaxed, then we took the restraints off one at a time. He was restrained 4 points, which means that his legs were restrained. Each leg was restrained, as well as each arm was restrained. Each hand was restrained to protect him from getting hurt, hurting himself. There are certain times also that his body reacted to where there was scratches on his body. They were not there before that at all. There were scratches, tree scratches, that appeared to us out of nowhere. And that was just showing us how wrong this demon was. But again, love prevails over evil. We know that Jesus does love us. We know that Jesus was in that room, that Jesus was going to heal Kevin physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And again, Kevin had to agree to it, totally agreed to it. There was one time I remember when Kevin said, I want this to stop. And so that is his right to do that. What we had to discern was that Kevin saying that he wanted to stop the exorcism, or was it the demon? It was a fine line, very fine line. And again, the priest decided to stop. And then 2 or 3 minutes later, we began again. And again, Kevin's body began to thrash around. The priest during the exorcism
Okay, Robert.
We attended to his wound, and then, and what made this even more unbelievable is that minutes later, these wounds would disappear completely.
Okay, let me ask you something real quick. Now, a couple quick questions. You had mentioned, obviously, that, you know, this had kind of, I'm assuming, come out of the blue. There was no, I mean, because I know in regards of follow-up and pre-doing all this, you have to ask, you know, were you exposed to this and that? Did you involve yourself in any sort of type of ritual, any sort of stuff with Ouija boards, stuff with this and that? I'm trying to remember, did you say that there was anything, or was it just some unknown cause that caused him to apparently become demonically possessed?
I asked Kevin if he ever had dealt with a Ouija board, and he said no. But during that time, Kevin was dealing in a lot of drugs, a lot of booze. His life was coming unhinged, and it was really a perfect storm. The devil knows, the evil one knows, when we are at our lowest. And in doing so, that is a portal, that is an opening for the demon, for the devil, for Satan, for Lucifer, to come inside of us. So when we're frustrated, we're angry, we're using a lot of drugs, using a lot of booze, we just open ourselves up to those types of things. Okay. Now, the next story that I will be telling you about in a couple minutes about Vivian is totally different.
Okay.
It is totally different.
Well, let me ask you one more thing, Robert, because like I said, I try to let you roll, and then I kind of jump in with three or four little questions. Bale is beyond, obviously, him announcing himself or itself. I don't know if it has a particular sexuality, but are there certain calling cards for certain demons? Like, is there a certain type of behavior, a certain maybe the victim is, you know, tearing at themselves more or something like that, or trying to eat things or regurgitating certain things? Is there certain signs and tells that you can identify with certain demons?
There are certain things that Baal is one of the strongest demons. There is a Zuzu, that is another one. Momo is another one. And so one must be very careful. Each of them have their own different types of power, but Baal is one of the strongest ones. Very, very, very strong. Very, very dangerous. Very dangerous. Baal is one of the closest to Lucifer, to Satan, whatever you want to call the devil, those certain names. He is the closest one to really the evil one, the closest one. So Baal has a lot of power, a lot of power. Very, very dangerous demon. Very, very dangerous.
Okay.
And so one has to be very, very careful. Did Kevin ask for this? No, he did not. Did Kevin do anything to open himself as a portal? No, Kevin did not at all. Not at all. He never, in fact, Kevin never went to church. He believed in God, but never went to church. He wasn't a Satanist. He did not pray to Satan. He did nothing like that. But again, that Kevin's life was a shambles. He was having a hard time with booze, with drugs, and all sorts of things. And again, it was a perfect storm. During the exorcism, there were other things, like I said before, doors would open up. There was a stench was unbelievable, where at certain times we had handkerchiefs because the smell was so bad. The thing about this, which was so unbelievable, that we could smell it, but Kevin could not. Because during certain times when the stench was so immense, Kevin was asking us, why are we using our handkerchiefs with our nose, you know, up to our faces? And we told him that the stench was so bad, but he did not smell it at all. Now, when I talked to Kevin and we went to see him in his home, he did smell the stench. He did. But this time, when we were doing the exorcism, he was not aware of the stench at all. I must also tell you that Kevin did have a dog, and he still does, and the dog was even acting very, very aggressive to Kevin while Kevin was at home, very, very much so. So again, the demons know how to get to us. They will attack us as well as attacking animals. They will attack anything that is close to our heart to hurt us, okay? The dog has been blessed. The dog is no longer come on air with us and talk about what he remembers, and hearing him tell the story of what was going on with him and the things that he remembers with his own exorcism will be very, very enlightening and very, very riveting. And again, I'm not pressuring Kevin at all. I'm leaving it up to Kevin. Kevin has not seen the video of his exorcism. He doesn't want to, and we respect that. At any time that Kevin wants to see that, Kevin has every right to see that. But at this very moment, Kevin's life is, like I said, remarkably a zillion times better, right. Very much so. Well, like I said, that people want to hear about the gore and what people are going through emotionally and physically and spiritually within exorcism. And let me tell you, it is an eye-opener. It is nothing to play with.
Right.
Well, very, Robert, very dangerous for everyone.
Sure. Robert, I'll say this, and just the thing is what people lose sight of is that this is a very real trauma, and these people carry the psychological scars, sometimes the physical scars of this, well beyond the event. And people have, again, the sort of that Hollywood vibe of it. And, you know, at the end of the movie, everything seems okay, and then the kid seems happy, or the family is returned basically to normal, and everything's back, you know, back on kilter. But in the realities of this, it's just like, again, an extremely hard shock to the system, and the oppression of that, I'm sure you takes years and years to ever feel maybe fully safe again and get past that invasion, which is truly what it was. You know, you have something taking control of you that, you know, you have no say in. I will say, obviously, in time, if this is something he would choose to do, that's fine. You know how I am. I'm very respectful of my guest, and if he wants to do that, that's fine. And if not, that's fine too. You know, like you said, there's no pressure in this. I always feel if something's meant to happen at a certain time, it will happen at a certain time. So
right, you know. Right. And Kevin at times does see a psychologist when he feels that he is beginning to slip. He will call me and tells me what is going on with him, and that he wants to talk to a priest who is a psychologist. And so I get with the priest, and I go with Kevin to see this priest. More times than not, Kevin and I will just talk, and just to lower his anxiety. I know that the psychiatrist, just right after the exorcism, and I can say this, that the exorcist, who is a psychiatrist, did put Kevin on some anti-anxiety medication just for a bit, just to get him over the edge, just to get him calm, because anyone who goes through a traumatic situation like he did, or anyone who goes through an exorcism, it is life-changing. And so Kevin, again, is doing well. Of course, we all have valleys and peaks, you know, in our everyday life, and Kevin goes through them. Kevin deals with them differently now than he ever did before. Kevin is a remarkable young man. He's 32 years old. Like I said, I talk to him a couple times a month. I see him at any time he wants to see me. So we stay very, very close and in touch with each other. He knows that I'm there for him, as well as the church is there for him anytime. And again, there is a very fine line, because at any moment, he could be repossessed. You know, some of these stories that you see on TV, that the possession, you know, the exorcism is over and such like that, and then everybody lives happily ever after. But that's not reality. The reality of it is that once that someone is possessed, there is that possibility, very high possibility, that the person can be repossessed. And so Kevin understands that. Kevin knows what to do to live a good life, to live a very productive life. He knows what to do and not to do. He knows that when he gets very frustrated, that if he begins to stuff his anger and frustration, he is people call me, we see a psychologist, and 2 or 3 days later after that, he is calmed down. But again, people have to realize that this is like major surgery, okay? And so with major surgery, a lot of people end up in ICU. There is a long recovery, and with an exorcism, because it's just not physical, it's also spiritual as well as emotional. And so the recovery time is lengthy. Sometimes the recovery is, you know, takes place until a person has passed away, until God calls that person home. So Kevin understands that, and Kevin is doing very, very well. Very, very well. And I praise God for bringing Kevin into my life. I believe that God puts us where we need to be at any given time. And Kevin reached out to me, and again, Kevin did not know who I was from Adam or Eve. He received my name from someone else who heard me on the radio. And so then that's how he reached out to me. But again, what you see on TV is just the tip of the iceberg of what a person goes through emotionally, spiritually, and physically. And most people on TV see the physical part of it, yet it is the emotional part also. It is like he was telling us that it is like seeing your life flash in front of you a zillion times a second. And during that time of seeing his life, the demon Baal would come in and distort things. The things that Kevin remembered as a child would be distorted by Baal, and that would hurt Kevin terribly. And he remembers, and that's how he fought back. He fought back because he knew what he experienced as a child, the happy times, and we all have happy times in our childhood, and the things that he remembered that made him so very, very happy, Baal distorted those things, and he knew that that was not correct. And so, again, Kevin is doing very well. Like I said, the doors would shake, the windows would shake, the bed would shake, but it never elevated. The stench was unbelievable. Did he vomit? Yes, he did. Was it projectile vomit? Yes, it was. Was it green, like pea soup, like, you know, rated on the exorcist? No, it was not. And you know what? I can talk about this, and it just doesn't come close to really what I experienced. There are some things that it's very, very difficult to put into words. Very, very difficult.
Right.
Each of us who were in that room for that exorcism, we went for counseling afterwards also, to assist us, because it is traumatic to each of the persons inside the room during this exorcism, because you will have dreams. I know that I was going to do this radio interview tonight with you, Steve, on the House of Asher, and last night's dream that I had about what I experienced with Kevin was unbelievable. It was like I was there again, seeing Baal, seeing the demon come through, and that was incredible, this dream that I had, very, very much so. But again, my angels are with me, my angels protect me, Jesus protects me, and so I knew I was well protected, yet again, my dream that I had last night was so vivid, it was like I was in that room again, and it's something that I needed to experience. So I could talk about it tonight, and I just praise God that my dream didn't last that long.
I'm sure.
So I could talk about it today. But again, Kevin is doing really, really well. I know people want to talk about other things. I know that during the time, because his girlfriend was there also, that Baal began to start on her, to talk about her and her life. And during that time, Father Michael would put holy water on the on Kevin and tell the demon that, you know, that to leave her alone. And again, that was difficult at times because the demon, like I said, will start talking.
Robert, let me ask you something real quick.
My girlfriend had to leave several times through the room because she was being bombarded terribly by Bale. And again,
that was actually
Kevin and his girlfriend do go to counseling together. They did that right afterward.
Good.
And both are doing remarkably well now.
Well, let me ask you one thing. That was actually kind of where I was going to go with this next before we get into this next story. How often does, because, and the reason I ask this is there's things that kind of overlap. Like if you take sometimes people talk about having ghostly visitations, and then some people talk about having alien visitations. You kind of lay the experiences over, and they kind of they match up on a lot of key points. How often, and the reason I'm asking this is just for some reason it come to me. How often in, say, a family line, because you know you hear about people who are supposedly their bloodline is cursed, or there's some sort of maybe a deal was made by, you know, generations back. How often does, like, say, a certain demon or group of demons oppress a certain bloodline or a certain family? Or is that common, or is that Hollywood?
It's a combination of both. I know that there is something called generational curse. That generations will, long time ago, many, many generations ago, they will be cursed for one reason or another. And so that happens, okay? But in Kevin's case, there was no curses that he heard of. There was no other family members that has ever gone through anything like this. And again, Kevin's situation, what was going on with him, was just a perfect storm. And again, all of us have to be very, very careful. Very careful. When all three spheres of our life, which are physically, emotionally, and spiritually, then we are opening ourselves to the demons. Okay? So one has to be very, very careful. And also, the baggage that we have accrued during our lifetime, that begins to build up and build up and build up, and we begin to stuff those so deep down into the intercessions of our hearts, of our minds, that comes like a volcano that begins to erupt. So my suggestion to everyone, please, everyone needs to come to some closure with a lot of things that have happened to us in the past. And if not, that baggage is carried on and carried on and carried on. And it disturbs, it bothers, it erupts when you least expect it. And I know the people that I have counseled, that I have done readings with, that the psychic part of me sees baggage around them with a lot of mold, a lot of gravel, a lot of dirt and moss. That is an indication to me that there are things that the person has held so closely inside of them that began to stuff them, that they need to come to some closure with that. And that is most difficult. And like I said before, Steve, that it is like an onion, and an onion has a lot of layers. And so we have to begin to peel the onion back to get to the core of the situation. And by getting to the core of the situation, then that's when the healing physically, emotionally, spiritually can begin. And so what we did in my Kevin experience is that we peeled back the many, many layers of what went on with his life. We got to the core of the situation, that was Bale had been with him for a long, long, long time because of what had happened to him in the past. Is Kevin. Kevin is no angel. I am no angel, okay? We have all done things that we're embarrassed about. There are things that we are ashamed of, okay? Those things need to have closure, and then we need to move on.
Okay.
And again, Kevin is doing remarkably well. And again, hopefully within the next couple months, maybe sometime next year, just when Kevin is ready, that Kevin wants to come on air with me and Steve, and you can hear what he has experienced. Now, there are some things that he does not remember, and thank God for that, okay? And that is just how watch any of the ghost stories anymore, never watches those at all. A lot of those things on TV or just theatrics, okay? He has lived it, and so he knows what reality is. And what those shows on TV truly is not reality. It truly isn't. Unfortunately, a lot of people have become obsessed by watching these, you know, types of shows. And again, if you see these shows that, like Ghost Adventures and such like that, that the spirits come out all the time, and that's not reality. There are spirits around us 24/7. Yes, that is very correct. They are around us. Millions of spirits. They pass through, they pass by, and they leave us alone more times than not. So when you watch these different shows on TV, always remember that a lot of it is for ratings, okay? A lot of it is they're trying to make a buck, and they do that.
Well, it's entertainment. I mean, you know, you can't. This is not a documentary. No matter generally how much you try to keep it as pure and as you know methodical to the scientific method and whatnot, depending on if you come at it spiritually or as an academic, you know, the producers are going to have their say. They can take it however they want to and cut stuff and add music and add whatever sort of situations. But I was going to ask you one more thing before we get into the second story. Now,
go ahead.
Now we've discussed some, you know, media and we mentioned The Exorcist and things like that. There was a movie called The Possession of Emily Rose. And I remember there was a woman that was part of the trial after her passing and had mentioned, well, because in her particular belief, I don't remember if it was Hindi or what it was, so please don't get upset with me, anybody, but said that due to certain medications, it blocked them up where they could not go through the possession experience to be able to release the demon, and it basically locked their bodies into a mode of possession. Where do you come from that? I mean, obviously you come from the Roman Catholic, you know, background and dogma and all that, but did you find people who have been either eventually locked up due to they weren't able to get through certain things who you felt were basically possessed, or did you feel, well, you know, maybe that had an element to it, but you don't necessarily think that was the driving force behind it? What do you find
in
that?
And the movie of Emily Rose, The Exorcism of Emily Rose, it is very true that she was on some psychotropic medication, and when that happens, it alters one physically and emotionally and spiritually. And if a person isn't off those types of medication, the exorcism will not work. It will not be a success. And the reason why is because the person is altered. And in Emily Rose's case, that's what happened to her. That's what happened to her. That movie is loosely based on a true story. Very loosely based on a true story. And again, she was on medication. She had a type of epilepsy, and it did alter her physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And the exorcism was not a success. It wasn't. Did she end up going to hell? No, she didn't. No, I truly believe, as well as the Catholic Church believes, that Emily Rose is in heaven.
She seemed, from the character, you know, at least from what I could see, and from the case, you know, case studies that we've seen, and audio and that, it seems like she was a very devout person. I think that she truly wanted to be freed of whatever she felt was inhabiting her, and just unfortunately, it didn't go as planned. And I think that's, how do I say this? I do not want to say, well, this is a cautionary tale. People should be aware and take and suspend, you know, any of the horrors that actually happened there. But what I mean is, you have to go into it going like, look, if this is a true situation and these demons are real, they can hurt you and they're nothing to play with. That's, again, like you were talking about certain shows. I've always said, look, if I have an inkling of something that's truly dark, I'm gone because I am not prepared for that. I'm completely aware self-aware of my abilities and my limitations. So I think sometimes that does a disservice in regards of making people think they can kind of flex up on spirits or demons or whatever.
Right. In Emily Rose's case, that she was raised in a very strict Roman Catholic family. There wasn't a lot of... the family was very, very close to a fault, if that makes sense to you, of where she did not get to experience life until she went to college. And when she got to go to college, then her life began to change. She experienced so much. She experienced friends. She experienced love. She experienced a lot. And so there was a confliction of her being raised in a very conservative Catholic Christian family of where, in fact, they did not dance and those types of things. They wore certain clothing. So when she got to college, she felt this freedom. And so she was in conflict with that. Am I doing it? Am I following what I was raised to believe? And so she was in conflict all the time regarding that. Did she come down with a physical ailment? Yes, she did. She did. And she was put on medication. The medication at times did not work. They tried several different types of medication. But the bottom line to all of this, did she need to be exercised? Yes, she did. Yet, having her on medication, the exorcism was not a success. It wasn't, because again, her entire body was altered. Her mind was altered. Physically, she was altered. Spiritually, she was altered. And in doing so, that the exorcism was not a success.
Right.
It wasn't.
Which, in as anyone who knows from the movie, ultimately all these factors come together to the point where she was not able to hold out, and she ended up passing away. Let me ask you this: in about the last 15 minutes we got left, please tell us about this second exorcism that you were involved in.
Yes, Vivian. Vivian is a at the time this was several years ago. Vivian. At the time was 48 years old. Vivian's story is very compelling. She had gone through a life of a lot of abuse, a lot of ritual abuse. Talk about family dynamics. She was in a family that was in the occult. So she was raised not as being a Christian, being raised in an occult of Satanists and those types of things. And so she was raised with that. And then all at once, after years of this, then all at once her family became Christian. But again, the damage with Vivian was already there. She was damaged physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Okay? She was on medication. The doctors had deemed her schizophrenic because she would throw herself on the floor. She would pull her hair and those types of things. When Vivian's family reached out to me regarding what was going on, I knew at the time, after hearing their story of what was going on, and me being a psychic medium, picking up certain things, that this exorcism was going to be lengthy. Because she had been on medication, psychotropic medication, for many years. And in doing so, we had to be very, very careful of slowly getting her off of this medication. When I saw Vivian, she was sitting on the floor, very depressed. Her face was very, very depressed, and right now I can see her in my mind's eye, sitting on the floor. She was rocking back and forth. She was singing a song. I have no idea what the song was. I had never heard of it before. She began to pull her hair out. She began to scream. She began to say things in different languages, in Latin and in Greek. And it wasn't Vivian. Vivian didn't know Latin or Greek, just, you know, for anything. Vivian, Toby's medication, as well as what was going on with her in all of her life. She was used and abused within her own family. There were a lot of family secrets. And talk about the onion. This onion was massive, of where the layers and layers and layers of ritual abuse within the Satanist group as a child, and the things that she had seen, the sacrifices, animal sacrifices, bloodletting, drinking of blood, and those types of things.
So you're not, I mean, it's not like, well, mom and dad dabbled with the Ouija board, or they, you know, whatever this and that, or maybe went ghost hunting or something like that. You're talking about this is a legitimate, like Rosemary's Baby, generational after generation of this type of cult activity.
Oh, very much so, yes. And those are the most dangerous, you know, being with Kevin and insisting, you know, Kevin and such was, I can't say a walk in the park because it was difficult, very, very difficult. Yet again, Kevin had never delved into. Kevin's family were not Satanists and those types of things. So Vivian came with all this baggage, and so did her family. Her family really, after talking with them for a lengthy time, that they really kind of dismissed of what had gone on. You know, and it just wasn't her parents, and just within the family, it started with both of her parents when they were young, because that's how her parents met. Okay, and again, Vivian was in her 40s when she reached out to me. And so again, talking to the family, doing the family dynamic, talking about what was going on, their perception of what went on was totally different than what Vivian experienced. And again, I had to validate their experience and Vivian's experience, because that is their perception. That is their perception. When I went to see Vivian, the house was cluttered. It was a mess. The air was thick. I sensed before I even went there that something was completely wrong. Very, very dangerous. Very dangerous. Vivian's story that I want to tell, I know that we're running out of time, that we will go into more of it later, because it is more extensive than what Kevin's was. And each person, of course, is different. But when you go, when you experience the ritual, sadistic, Satanist things that Vivian had gone through, it's a whole new ball game. Completely different. Completely different. I must tell you that Vivian now is doing very well. Very well. There are certain things that she continues to work on. There's things that her family continues to work on. And again, it is totally different than what Kevin had experienced. Totally different. When it comes to a female who is psychologically ill, as well as being possessed, it's a whole different ballgame. Different, completely. And we don't have time tonight, unfortunately. But another time, Steve, I can go into more detail, because again, it was layers and layers of this onion that we had to get to the core. And the core of it just wasn't the fact that Vivian had been raised in a family of Satanists. That was just the tip of the iceberg. But what she saw, what she experienced, the ritual abuse, sexual abuse by others within this cult, changed her completely.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this, and like I said, and we will keep the more in-depth details of Vivian's possession for another show, which is, you know, I'm always glad to have you back on, and we, you know, we've talked off air, definitely plan on having you back on anyway. I will ask you then, in regards of, you know, I don't want to say a casual possession, because I don't think there's such a thing. It would seem that you wouldn't, I'm trying to remember the terminology Father Malachi Martin talked about someone who is perfectly possessed. A lot of times it's from, like you said, a generational thing to where they've been raised and groomed into this, where it's kind of all that they've known. Now, how often in the exorcisms and things that you've dealt with have you come across that scenario as opposed to sort of the sort of left field unexpected? I mean, you would sort of expect somebody who has had their hands in a lot of darker elements and a lot of maybe more ritual magic, and especially sacrificing of animals and God knows what else. How often would you say, like, a percentage is that as opposed to just an unfortunate person who came into it? Right.
I think that there are probably thousands of people who have been through the same thing, and maybe even worse than what Vivian's gone through, that need to be exercised. Yet, at times, people are afraid. They're afraid, they're ashamed of what their family did and what their part was. So more times than not, that those types of people live a horrible, miserable life because they do not reach out. They're afraid to reach out. They're afraid to relive everything that they have gone through. And I think there's thousands of people in this world that have been involved in those types of things. Now, again, Vivian was very, very young, when she experienced this abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, ritualistic abuse, drinking of blood, sacrificing animals, and those types of things. And so when she reached out to me, it took me back to the time of where I was living in Florida as a criminal working for the state of Florida as a criminal profiler, and I wanted to go to a Santeria, which is like voodoo, but only within the Hispanic community, Santeria, and I wanted to experience that. And experiencing that opened my eyes to so much. And so working with Vivian, then a lot of that experience, my past experience within the Santeria occult, really helped me a lot. And again, to find the right priests, the exorcists, to do this, who are versed in voodoo and or Santeria, it is difficult at best. Yet there are Catholic priests that are out there that know of ritual satanic groups, and those people who their exorcisms are different in many, many, many ways. And again, two of the same priests did the exorcism on Vivian, and there were other priests involved that knew of Santeria, who knew Spanish, because the demon inside of her just did not speak Latin or Greek, but also Spanish and French. Wow. And so that whole scenario with Vivian and what she experienced and how she would pull her hair out of down to the roots. She tried to dig her eyes out. She tried to hurt herself all the time. She was a self-mutilator also. Mm-hmm. And again, that is a psychological illness. There's a reason behind it. Yet there's also the fact that she would be cut. She was made to cut herself during these ritualistic, satanic things that they were involved in. And again, right, when it comes to a woman, a female, who needs an exorcism, it's a different ballgame, completely different.
Right. Well, Robert,
there are some things that Vivian did that would make people sick to their stomach when I talk about them. Right. And again, it is not the gore that I want to talk about. It's just the fact that it is difficult. It was very, very difficult. If you think Kevin's exorcism lasted 3 days. Vivian's lasted longer.
Right. Robert, I'm sorry, we're almost out of time. Can you please give me either a email, or I know you do a lot of work with outreach programs and feeding the poor. Is there anything you want to say in the last couple of minutes before I start the outro?
Yes, if someone wants to contact me, please do. My telephone number is 309-213-0325. I must also thank Jason Bland of Paranormal Soup, a great friend, a great supporter of me, and I appreciate that. And Steve, thank you so very much for your help. And I'm going to be getting a new website. My website that I had been hacked, and so I'm in the process of getting a new website. You can friend me on Facebook if you want to, but again, my telephone number is 309-213-0325. And again, thank you, Steve, House of Asher, for having me on air, and I hope that we can talk soon again. I will continue to talk about Vivian and her exorcism, as well as another time I would like to talk about the hospice that I work with, that I go into someone's home, and I help children, young children, cross over from this earthly dimension to the heavenly dimension.
Absolutely,
and we will talk about angels.
Totally will. And there's so much more that we can get into on that, and I look forward to having you back on. But I do want to thank everybody for tuning in for this episode of House of Asher. You know, I learned as much as you guys do, and I hope to keep learning, and it's a hard pill to swallow, but there are certain things out there that, you know, you do need to be prepared for, and not everything's Hollywood, not everything's fun times. Some of this stuff is very real, and you have to be respectful of it and prepare yourselves. But I want you guys to enjoy the rest of the day, but as the sun goes over the trees and the shadows grow long, I want you to make sure to check your closet. Check under your bed. Make sure that there's not anything nefarious under there. And if so, maybe say a little prayer. Clear it out of there. But until next time, love each other. Love yourselves. You know, take care of one another. But don't be afraid to allow yourself to be a little scared. As long as it's safe. And you take precautions. Thank you all again. Take care. Bless you. And until next time, I'll see you around. Take care.